Hello there and welcome to this video. My name is Riley and today we're going to be taking a look at a cryptocurrency which is trying to win the race as the top privacy coin in the whole cryptocurrency space. What am I talking about? Monero. And just like all my other videos, we're going to look at what is Monero, the features of it, why it's useful, the team and the community behind it, where you can buy and store it, the roadmap and a bit on the future, my thoughts on the future, as well as a little technical analysis at the end. And I also want to preface this video by saying that this is just for educational purposes and I am not a financial advisor. This is not financial advice. So, without further ado, let's get into it, shall we? Alright, so now what is Monero? Well, Monero is an open source, decentralized cryptocurrency which focuses on primarily delivering secure, private, and untraceable transactions. Now, Monero is a fork, is a fork of Bitcoin, which was originally named BitMonero, but it has been since rebranded and renamed as Monero. Now, for the coins, we have currently circulating about 15.5 million coins, which this is a nice, good, low amount for a decentralized currency, and the total is a nice, low 18.4 million, so about 3 million less than Bitcoin. And for the coins, it is a proof-of-work coin, and mining will continue until the 31st of May in 2022, but after this, to keep the miners incentivized because they will no longer have a block reward, 0.3 XMR or the cryptocurrency used known as on the Monero platform will be released per minute in order to keep the miners incentivized beyond transaction fees because they're not that big. Now the block time for Monero is quite fast compared to other coins like Bitcoin with a block time of 2 minutes, so it allows for a bit more scalability in that sense. And the block reward is something, it varies depending on the size of the block, and this is something that we'll get into in a second. The difficulty adjustment also for Monero is every block, so that's a really good feature of it. So, now the features of Monero. In a normal cryptocurrency like, say, Bitcoin, you have two keys. You have two main keys. You have a public and a private key. Well, in Monero, it's a little bit different in that you have two public keys and two private keys. And so I'm going to get into these now. And the first one is the public view key. And the public view key is the one which is used to generate one-time stealth public addresses where the funds will be sent to the receiver. And this will make more sense as I explain the thing, other features about this cryptocurrency. The private view key is used by the receiver to scan the blockchain to find the funds sent to them. So this is to find the funds which someone has sent them in a private transaction. Now the public spend key will help the sender to take part in ring transactions, which is a thing I will talk about in a second, and also verify the signature of the key image, which is also a part of private transactions. The private spend key helps in creating that key image, so the key image that I talked about in the previous key, which enables them to send transactions. And so it doesn't matter if you don't really get these at the moment. This is just sort of a preface to what I'm about to explain. So if you watch this and then come back to these keys, then you'll understand why we have all these keys. And so the first one I want to talk about is ring signatures. And basically what happens is when you want to send a private transaction, your signature, so in a transaction you have a signature, and you sign it yourself, and your signature is randomly mixed with a number of different decoy signatures. It doesn't have a fixed value. You can choose how many signatures you want to mix with it. And what this does, it creates a new signature. So how it works is first you get your ring size determined, so how many signatures, decoy signatures you want to use. And these are random outputs taken from the blockchain, which have the same value of your transaction. So say you want to send 10 Monero or XMR, it'll find other transactions to use as decoy signatures with 10 XMR, so it doesn't look invalid on the chain. And just like I said before, you can change your ring size, but you have to realize that a bigger ring size will increase the transaction fees because the transaction size is bigger. And also the sender has to sign all the signatures before it is processed, but the other decoy signatures, those people do not have to sign it. And you might say, well, doesn't this mean you could double spend? But what happens is, like I said before, I mentioned something called a key image. And what happens is every transaction will come with a unique image, which miners can check to prevent double spending. So if that transaction has that key image and that checks out, they will verify that transaction. And if it doesn't, they will not approve the transaction. So the next thing I want to talk about is stealth addresses. And so what happens is, in order to process a transaction, the sender will need uses the recipient's public view key and their public spend key to generate a unique one-time stealth address. And what this does, when this is created, your XMR is sent to this address. And then the recipient on the other end uses their private spend key to scan the blockchain for this transaction. And what it does, this calculates a private key which corresponds to the stealth address and then gives them access to the XMR. So only if you have the right private spend key, will it scan the blockchain and calculate it correctly. Otherwise, other addresses won't calculate it correctly and therefore won't have access to that XMR. And then there's another thing called ring confidential signatures. And to make these transactions even more private and untraceable, what it does is it hides the amount of XMR you're sending on the blockchain in order to make it untraceable. So even though you couldn't tell who it necessarily came from because you had ring signatures and the decoy signatures, you could sort of nail it down to a closer range of people if you had the amount of XMR that they sent. But since you don't, it's untraceable. And some other features, Corvry and I2P. And so I2P is named the Invisible Internet Project. And what it is, it's a routing system which allows apps to send messages to each other in a private fashion without outside interference. And then Corvry, which I think that's how you pronounce it, is actually something which is in development. And what it is, it actually hides your internet traffic so that a passive network monitoring system won't reveal that you're using Monero at all. So this is, it's like an incognito way of using Monero. And all your Monero will be encrypted and routed through these I2P nodes. So like I said, it's a routing system which uses private messaging. And so this will run through these nodes which run I2P. And the nodes will know that your messages are passing through, but will have no idea exactly where they are going or what the contents of the message are. So you can't identify what's actually in there. So why is Monero useful? Well, there's a few reasons why it's useful. And the first one is fungibility. And if someone uses, like for example, if someone uses Bitcoin for illegal purposes and someone was able to trace back to which coins were used, these coins would be forever, I guess you could say, stained with the previous transactions, like the previous illegal transactions. It would be, even though they would be the same amount of Bitcoin, they would be sort of technically worth less than these sort of clean coins that didn't have illegal spending attached to them. I probably should have mentioned this before I used the example of Bitcoin, but for those who don't know, fungibility is basically the interchangeability of an asset of a particular specification. So in simple terms, it means it's an equal value of assets which can be swapped in any sort of form. And now I'll give you a good, easy example to understand. Gold is a fungible asset because if you have the same concentration of gold, so like the same carat specification of gold, whether it be in form of coins or rings or whatever it is, if you had the same amount of gold, it is worth the same amount of value in sort of in dollar price. Now, like I said before, Monero is fungible, and this means that you can use any Monero interchangeably and they'll be at the same value because they won't have this ability to be stained, if you will, like Bitcoins can. So that's just a really good way to make sure that you keep the value in your coins. And this is due to the fact that the coins are untraceable and you can't identify them if they were aligned with illegal activities and things like that. And the second way is dynamic scalability. And so Monero does not have a set block size. However, in order to prevent spam attacks using huge, huge blocks, a block reward penalty is used. And this is what I was talking about before, how the block reward changes. So how it works is, I think it's the last 100 blocks. It'll choose the median over the last 100 blocks. And if it goes, if you make a block 10% bigger than the median, it'll reduce by 10%. And I think it goes like 25 to 25, or even possibly in a square relationship. So the bigger your block gets, the sort of the square of that decrease will occur into your block reward. And also, Monero is kind of ASIC resistant. It's not technically, it's not designed to be ASIC resistant, but the cost of manufacturing ASIC chips is a bit too expensive for an individual, which makes it economically unviable. However, there are still mining pools with around 43% of the hash rate being owned by three different mining pools. And people might look at this and think, well, oh, that's very centralized. But if you actually take a look at how the Bitcoin hash power is distributed, it's not that much compared to Bitcoin. So privacy, also something, a big thing that we talked about before. The transactions are untraceable, as there are loads of transactions with the same value and the value is unknown. So that's what I talked about with confidential ring signatures. But this does make large transaction sizes, and this is one of the big problems for the Monero network. Also, just a recent use case we've seen for Monero, XMR is being used as a payment method for the recent Mariah Carey and G-Eazy albums. So that's a cool thing to see. Now, the community and the team behind Monero, they've got a pretty good community, actually, like a pretty solid community. Monero's Twitter has about 113,000 followers. Could be even more now. And Ricardo Spagni, which is one of the creators of Monero, has 16,000 Twitter followers on his own personal account. On Reddit, they've got 47,000 readers, which is quite a good number. On Stack Exchange, they got about 5,000 visitors per day. And on the Bitcoin forums, they're very, very active with a lot of discussion. And so with the team for Monero, like I mentioned before, it's open source. And Monero has quite a large team overall, but it has 7 core developers and then a few dozen more sort of just other developers, as well as people in other areas of the project. But a lot of these people do not reveal their identity. There are a couple, and the couple who do actually are quite good and have quite a bit of experience in their fields. So it's good to see. One of the core devs has had quite a lot of experience in large companies. So that's good too. But as long as the main thing really with the team is as long as they're giving what they're promising. And so Monero undergoes development updates, which are currently planned to occur every 6 months, which adds new features and security enhancements. And these schedule updates basically force Monero to evolve and give the users confidence to know that their team is actually working hard on the project. And they actually seem to be delivering on their promises with these updates. And so this sort of regular interval of updates is great for investor confidence and promotes regular growth. So now, where do you buy and store your XMR or your Monero? Well, in terms of buying, you've got quite a few different options when it comes to XMR. As you can see here, basically any of the main exchanges that people use nowadays, like we can see BitHum, got huge volume, that's the big Korean exchange, HitBTC, Bittrex, Poloniex, Bitfinex, Binance, Kraken, all the large exchanges that are used nowadays, you can get them on. And if you trade cryptos, you're probably on one of these exchanges, so therefore you can probably buy Monero. In terms of storing your Monero, you've got a couple of different options, not a huge range, but at the moment the real two major options are for you: the Monero web wallet, the My Monero web wallet, and the Monero desktop wallet, which would be the recommended wallet I would use, because it's a desktop client, which is better than a web client. But cold storage is the best, but we don't currently have that with Monero. However, Jax, which is a multi-cryptocurrency wallet, and cold storage is actually coming soon for Monero, so keep that on the lookout. Now, the roadmap and my thoughts on Monero. Well, I've just summarized a couple of the points here from the future of Monero, and the first one is the Covery alpha release, which is what we talked about before, plus the implementation of multi-signature transactions and multi-sig technology into Monero. And basically, multi-sig is, in plain terms, transactions and technology which requires multiple signatures in order to verify a transfer of assets. And the future for Monero, the real future, which they're going to have to sort of knuckle down on and focus towards, is looking for second layer solutions to speed and scalability, to reduce transaction sizes and get more efficient ring confidential transactions. And one of the things which they are looking at implementing to reduce the transaction sizes are bulletproofs. And I won't go into what bulletproofs are, but all you need to know is that they have the potential to reduce the Monero transactions by up to 80%, which is huge. And that would be a huge thing for Monero. And for my thoughts on Monero, I think it's a great project with a great technology. And because of this, I think it has a potential for a more streamlined technology than other privacy chains, for example, Dash, because it's just a single layer network. But just like I talked about before, the transaction size and the scalability is what's actually holding Monero back at the moment. But if we can implement these sort of second layer solutions like bulletproofs, Monero, the sky's the limit. I'm telling you, this cryptocurrency has huge potential, and if we can get around the transaction sizes, this will be very, very used in the future. I can already see it. And so for a little bit of technical analysis, first we'll look at the... that's stellar lumens. Where are we? XMR, there we are. So for Monero, we can see that in terms of the US dollar price, we've just gone absolutely exponential over the past year, as most coins have. And the funny thing which Monero has different is that it didn't get this huge run up with the altcoin bubble, and it didn't have this burst. Instead, we saw this nice run up around August, and then a cool off, which led to another big run up, which we've had over the past couple of months. And we've had all-time highs up to about $360, and we've settled down at this $254 level. And in terms of the daily pattern, you can't really establish many patterns in terms of continuation patterns or reversal patterns just at the moment. But we can see large volumes coming out of Monero. Like, we can see these 3 days here, we've just had huge volume pouring out of it. And our RSI is running a little hot right now, but a little cool off wouldn't be too bad for it. As well as the MACD, we can see we're pinching at about the 30 level. But I want to just quickly point your eyes to, on scales, on graphs, what you can do, normal graphs do it in a linear scale, meaning that it'll go in a set set numeral of increments as it goes up. But what you can do, you can use something called a log scale to analyze trends, because it's quite easier. And basically, I won't explain how it works, but what a log scale does is it squishes everything into the one graph to make it easier to look at. And what you can see here, I've drawn this trend line here, and this is starting from the February of 2016, so nearly 2 years ago. We can see we've had this very, very consistent trend for Monero. And we've seen one run up here, which we've come back and set it on this trend line. But mostly we've seen this ride up on this line here. And at the moment we are getting a little bit away from this trend line, but not too much. I think if you compare it to something like this, this was around an 80% pullback, an 81% pullback. where to that trend line, that is. Whereas on here, we can see this all-time high. Hold on, let me just get it so it's on screen. This all-time high here, if it were to pull back, we're only at 60% now. So it's still got quite a bit of room to move. And I do think over the next year, it's going to have a really good year in terms of the USD price, definitely. Now, the BTC price, this one I won't use a log scale for, actually, because what we can see here, in terms of the BTC price, what we had in 2016, we had the big August run-up, and then we've pulled back, and we've sort of danced along, going up and down, like in a wave-like pattern on this trend line here, and we keep seeming to bounce off this trend line. Now, for short term, we have sort of established ourselves here around this sort of 0.0155 mark. But this trend line here would be the number that I would really be looking to buy in at. I do have a position in Monero at the moment, but I'm not looking to add anything in the short term unless it breaks through this trend line and gets towards this. I think it is just under 1.2 million sats. So what you're going to look for, I don't recommend buying it right now, even though it does sort of look like it's a bit on a bit of a discount compared to here. Although if you're buying very super long term, I have no doubts that it will go up in value anyway. But to maximize your profits, what I would do, I would wait till if it crosses this short-term trend line, this short-term support line here, and see how close we can get to this long-term support line. And if we do get to there, then I'll be looking to add a larger position of Monero. But until then, I'm good with my holdings. So, with that said, I want to thank you so much for watching this video. If you liked this video or found it helpful, please leave a like and a comment below. And make sure to subscribe, because I'll be bringing out future videos on other cryptocurrencies very soon. I'll catch you later.